All right, looks like we're picking this up right in the match. And we get to see Spec Ops Giraffe again. All right. So this is a pretty solid opener here.
And this is a tough opener with the Grazer. The great, you know, a 7 and an 8 mana card and only 3 land, even with the gross power on the Grazer. The Grazer helps you get lands in a play, but you still got to get a lot of them. You need to draw a lot of lands before you're casting those cards.
Oh, also, for everybody watching, after this round, we should be down to 64 players. So if that's helping you follow your single limb breakdown there.
Yes, hopefully all your brackets are still alive.
Yeah, that would be a whole separate contest we could do for CFB. Let everybody register and then give about 30 minutes for everyone to submit brackets. All right, so we did manage to find some land. On the other side, it looks like Must Be Nice is on just Bant Ramp. I have a feeling we're going to see a fair amount of both of these decks today.
Solemn Simulacrum, great draw.
Yeah, and for those of you at home, don't worry about adjusting your television sets there. It looks like we're just having some weird streaming issues from Spec Ops there. So.
Taquan, when you watch streams, do you watch them on TV or the computer? I often will watch on my TV, actually, while I'm playing a game or arena or something on my laptop. I'll turn a stream on the television.
Yeah, I actually do both. If I'm in this room in my little office, I'll watch it on one of my monitors. But
if I'm
cleaning up or something, I'll just put it on my TV while I'm cleaning the house or folding clothes or whatever.
I do the same thing, same exact thing, yeah. Ooh, that would have been a nice land to draw untapped.
Oh, no doubt.
Oh, it's that Ugin.
It's little Ugin.
I thought it was big Ugin. This is a way better hit than I thought when I was like, well, not enough lands. I thought all the cards cost 7 and 8. But yeah,
that Ugin. Little Morph Man that looks like it's a Simulacrum under there.
Yeah.
So now, even if they wipe the board, you don't feel too bad about it here. But they're probably not. I mean, they're just staring at a Simulacrum, so. But I'm not sure what their play is really to even get out of this here. I guess we're going to see Teferi, it looks like.
What happens if you phase out a morph creature?
I literally was just having that thought, and I think when you phase something out, if I remember right, everything that's attached to it goes with it.
But it's not attached, right? It's just face down.
Yeah, that's true. I think
my guess is it's going to come back.
I think it comes back as a 2/2 creature.
My guess is wait. In this case, it can be like a sorcery. Well, I'm stumped. Tokens come back? Okay. Chat is saying nothing changes.
Yeah, literally everything just comes back as it is. Like, phasing such a terrible thing. I mean, I'm glad it's only on a single card, but I hope we don't make a habit of bringing an ability back.
Yeah. There were many decks built around phasing in my youth.
If I remember right, one time when they first changed the rules on phasing, when they were first around, it had this weird thing where leaves play triggers happened, but enter the battlefield triggers did not happen when things phased in. So that made it even further confusing.
Right.
All right, well, we won that one pretty handily. Hopefully Spec Ops stream here isn't giving people motion sickness. Doesn't look like anything surprising or any new cards we didn't know about hiding out in the sideboard or anything from Spec Ops, so. If you were playing a video game, it looked like he just chose the standard build out package. All right, so we got three lands. Aether Gust, Growth Spiral, looks like an Omnath in there, and an Ultimatum. Early Growth Spiral with no land in hand. Found one, though.
Could have considered maybe paying two life to counter an opposing Mystical Dispute, but chose not to, which I think is fine. On the flip side, you see Spec Ops draft bluff a Mystical Dispute, which I just love.
Yeah.
that warms my heart.
Well, you know, because it slows your opponent down. If they have a Teferi or something, it's like, okay, well, maybe. Maybe yeah. I got to wait one more turn.
Nobody would pay two without a Dispute.
Which, you know, it's funny because it's one of those plays that works against high-level opponents. But if you're playing your local FNM, doesn't mean a damn thing.
No.
You just took a two damage for no reason at all. All right, so look, this Omnath's just going to hang out in hand for a little bit longer. Well, we picked up the 6-mana Ugin. And at some point, we're going to have to try to play some spells here, right?
I mean, with the shark, it makes things a bit more pressing for Spec Ops giraffe.
And this is pretty strong from Spec Ops, too, that we haven't missed a land drop when you're holding on to these ultimatums. Now, I don't think you want a third one, though. All right, Growth Spiral, and we found a land off that one.
Scavenging Ooze will speed up this clock a little bit while still allowing. Must be nice to have a couple answers up for whatever Spec Ops Giraffe happens to do on their turn. Giraffe may just go ahead and Gust this Ooze, though.
So we've got, what, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7? And we have the ability to play an 8th land? A little tough here because it's going to get met by Dovin's Veto. And we chose not to fight over that.
Can't. Dovin's Veto uncounterable.
Oh, that's so true. It is uncounterable. You are correct.
Yeah. It's sort of why I think you saw. I think that's what you saw. Must be nice thinking about what card to play, because if they hard cast the dispute on Ugin, it would have cost three of their four mana. So if Spec Ops Giraffe did have a card to fight, they couldn't have fought back, which is why I think in the end they went with the veto.
All right, we're only at 12 here, so looks like this Aether Gust is likely going to get used on something on this turn. Down to six. Rogue getting cast and deciding to target the ooze here. And Must Be Nice decides not worth trying to keep the ooze.
So here, it looks like Genesis Ultimatum plus Dispute is going to be able to fight through the Dispute, and Genesis Ultimatum should resolve if Giraffe goes for it.
All right, we're hoping to hit something good here. So, Dispute hit by another Dispute.
Ugh.
That's not great.
Yeah. Considering you just resolved a 7-mana card when you were staring down only a 3-3, you're still well behind the 3-3 on the board.
Wow. That's heartbreaking. I mean, that's definitely not how you want that to end up. So we go down to 3. So that's how much mana we got to get. 3, 5, 7, 9, 11.
Yeah, it looks like 11.
So you get one more untapped land. You could, in theory, try to play Cavalier and Ultimatum on the same turn.
Yeah, I mean, Cavalier first makes it pretty likely, I guess.
That almost feels like Teferi's bouncing there, kind of like, why not? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that was a lot better than the last time.
That was huge by comparison. You're going to get 3 life, a card, get to put a land into play, get lands off the Cavaliers, end up with 10 power with a creature still on the board.
I was thinking, you know, that wonder now if I was thinking that, you know, it might not be enough. Spec Ops Draft was at 3 at the time, and I was like, well, this Elspeth Conquers Death taking out that Cavalier might be enough for lethal. But now it looks like there may be 6 life and multiple Cavaliers in play, 9 life plus multiple Cavaliers in play.
Yep. It's a heck of a turnaround. That was a big, big turn. And they're going up to 9 life. And Ugin as a backup. I mean, not even just Ugin. I mean, you have Ugin with another Uro of your own to get out of the yard if you needed to. All right, so Must Be Nice is at least saying, hey, fine, if you want to trade, let's do it. Thank you. Is it better there, would you say, to block Uro to Uro or possibly give up one of your Cavaliers by double blocking?
It's possible. I guess it doesn't matter, but I guess it's possible you want to double block, because I mean the thing is you also get to put a huge threat on top of your deck from the graveyard if your Cavalier dies. Plus, in general, you want to be the one attacking with Uro, so when you block on defense, it means you don't get to attack and get a card. Whereas if you trade your other creatures, then your Uro gets to be on the offensive and you get to get the card advantage there too.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering. So, I mean, especially with the amount of mana that you had in play at that point, it was something like 14 lands. Like, you could really start playing multiple huge spells. Cool. Looks like we have a backup match, so we have some more magic for everybody. Awesome. We get to see Mr. Hadouken again.
The returning champion.
I don't know much about this Mr. Hadouken, but I got to give some credit. Seems like a very solid player and obviously already crushed one of these events. You know, it's one of the things we kind of talked a little bit about before the show was that, you know, with us being all in isolation, one thing we're learning is we're getting exposed to a lot of different personalities, both players, content creators, you know, commenters, streamers. So it's, even though we're all stuck at home, it kind of has been a positive experience for a lot of people.
Yeah, I've met a lot of new co-casters over the course of past few months for sure. I agree that, you know, CFB and WotC have stepped up and they're doing a lot of online coverage and expanding opportunity to a lot of creators, which has been really great as far as I'm concerned. And I agree with what you're saying. I've met a lot of cool new people that I've gotten to work with, and it has been a good experience.
Looks like we're taking a mulligan here. And I have no clue what I'd want to put back out of this hand.
Maybe just put back the Soul Seer. Yeah.
It looks like he agrees with you. Now, that being said, you know, we can see Nick Strahd's hand here, and it's not the most explosive thing either.
Right. Mr. Hadouken has struck me as a very strong player today in the few matches we've watched. Very obviously thinks through everything, and I feel has played very precisely.
We need to, I don't know, maybe I'll reach out, tell them to, we got to create a page so we can have the winners listed so you get some bragging rights.
Yeah.
Maybe start getting some check marks next to your name as you start piling up wins. Yeah, this is a tough spot, but it looks like probably going to go to keep an untapped land available to use that Aether Gust.
Yeah, I think I agree with the play. The drawback here is on the next turn, you can't leave up Mystical Dispute unless you draw yet another untapped land, but I think that's fine. I think it looks like you at least know you'll have Aether Gust in the case of Nissa, and there's not really a lot of other 5-mana green plays that you'd be all that worried about, but Steam Vent's good here because actually it allows him to leave up a counterspell if he has one, which we know he does. Or even cycle the triome. Is that how you say it? Triome at end of turn?
Some people say it both ways. I'm a triome person, but I think it's like, you know, potato, potato kind of thing.
Fair enough.
All right, so we're debating what to use on this Nissa. All right, so we just go with Aether Gust. Now this is kind of tough, right? Because you still want to be able to cast the Mystical Dispute here, I'm assuming.
You do. But also it's very telling from my perspective that your opponent has put Nissa on the bottom from an Aether Gust.
Yep.
At least I think they did. I thought they did, but it would lend me to believe they have another Nissa.
Looks like we just did a check to see how many things we had in the graveyard. You know, I think what you're saying, you know, that maybe this speaks to Mr. Hadouken's level here. But I think a lot of players instantly go, okay, great. I need to get this land into play here since it normally comes into play tapped anyway. But looks like Mr. Hadouken might be playing for the long game and possibly just cycling this.
Yeah, I think it will get cycled. But at this point, it's almost like a panic cycle. An unanswered Nissa almost just ends every game on the spot. Unfortunately for Mr. Hadouken, this Nissa, because of the mana generation from Nissa's passive, threatening to also put Ugin into play next turn, with Aether Gust up now, and Aether Gust available to protect Nissa and Ugin, Mr. Hadouken really needs to find something right away.
Yeah, even with the cycle here, I mean, you're looking at... Well, you'd have enough in the yard at that point, because I guess you got rid of the Fabled Passage to be able to use the Uro.
Wilderness Reclamation looks good, but...
Problem here is, though, we can see Nick's hand and see that there's a big Ugin awaiting.
Yeah, I mean, the Aether Gust is really a problem, too. Otherwise, Nissa could be finished off here by the explosion.
Yep, and that's going to get promptly... Oh, I say that. Like it was going to be instantly Aether Gusted, but there's some hesitation there. Let's it resolve.
I guess the explosion's going to get gusted.
I mean, I suppose so. I mean, I guess the idea is if maybe, well, I don't know, they're going to get it back next turn now. But I guess they only are really concerned with the following turn of getting the Ugin down anyway.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean... Ugin now comes down. Are you going to minus four on the wreck? I mean, you know there's an explosion on top. The way it actually looks like it might play out is like, all right, so Mr. Hadouken's going to take six down to 12. Then Ugin's going to minus four, killing only the Wilderness Reclamation potentially. But then Mr. Hadouken's going to get to untap, play another Reclamation, and then play Explosion for 5 on the Ugin, get hit from 12 down to 3, but at least have a turn untapped with Wreck and a bunch of lands, or maybe they can do something. Maybe it turns out that Innistrad chooses not to minus Ugin and just like kill the shark or something. But then the second Reclamation is going to let the Explosion be cast for like, what, a little 12 or 8 or something? And
yeah.
I don't know. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 14, 21, 17. So 13, I guess, I could have been cast for, if I'm not mistaken, which I very well might be.
All right. So we're going to go to 12. Redrawing that expansion explosion. But, I mean, you do it for enough, I guess, to kill Nissa here.
I'm not sure if you want to kill Nissa or Ugin.
Yeah, like, this is an just bad spot to be caught in. I mean, yeah, because he takes all your mana.
Oh, it's not a very good six cards. All mana.
Yeah, that's... All lands and reclamations, it's not really what you're looking for. Though you do get a turn to do or draw something here. I mean, I suppose you could have done much worse there. This at least buys you a turn, it looks like. So you can get one of the Uros out of the yard.
Now you play, this is actually really good. You put Uro into play from the graveyard, and then you explosion Ugin now. I mean, you're not quite out of the woods, but you're doing all right.
Oh, wait, actually, the opponent has a Blast Zone already.
Oh, is Blast Zone on 4 right now?
Oh, is it? I can't see the number. It looks like it's on 1.
That's what I thought. Yeah, so you're not going to die, though, because you can kill Ugin. You might lose your Uro and get hit back down to 3, but I think you're doing okay.
Yeah, this at least gives you a shot.
You can also leave up Aether Gust here in case of another Nyss on the other side. Maybe 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 8. I think I would. Can leave up Aether Gust. I actually think I like Mr. Hadouken's chances here. Although, another sort of whiff, but the important thing is being able to play Uro from the graveyard to keep your life total padded. Because this Uro is going to have to get killed off.
Yep. And you do have access to a second Uro as well if something were to happen to this one. All right, well, we just picked up a Growth Spiral on Nick's side there.
I would just Aether Gust any card here, I'm pretty sure. Like, I'm pretty sure I would just Aether Gust that, but I guess Mr. Hadouken chooses not to.
Oh.
He's going to attack and then Blast Zone before blockers because he needs to use the mana from the creatures that are attacking.
Makes sense.
Yep.
Send 6 damage comes through, sending Hadouken down to 3. Growth Spiral draws a land. Draw a Fabled Passage.
So I wonder if you're going to see potentially Mr. Hadouken scry before playing Uro here with the Castle of Antris. Looks like no.
So we don't have a lot of spells to get into the yard. So this Uro needs to hang around for a turn or two.
Maybe just play 2 more Wrecks.
Yeah, I was just about to ask. So you just go ahead and just play the Reclamations at this point.
I think so. I mean, you have a Dispute and 2 counters. You can pretty much hold down the fort. You can also, at the end of turn, scry a lot with the 2 Castle of Antrises. You'll be able to cast everything in your hand. And you can basically, I would basically choose within reason, like one card that I want to have on top of my deck and just dig to it. Maybe the best way to do that is Explosion. The best card to look for, I mean, is Explosion.
There you go.
Yeah.
I mean, you scry till you have a perfect 2, really, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, there's no reason to stop scrying until you top both, yeah. Or, I mean, if you run out of mana or whatever, obviously. Wow. It's amazing. This Petty Theft is almost lethal. But Mystical Dispute being cast here actually prevents one of the 3/3s from attacking. By, yeah. Like if Innistrad pays for it, he has to tap one of the attackers. So extremely close to lethal, but because if you want to pay for this Mystical Dispute, you have to tap your attacker. It actually almost only does 3 damage, and it will allow Mr. Hadouken to stick around and draw the explosion and win next turn.
So we've got 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 11, 12, 13 lands. So you times
three. Not 14 even after the steam vents.
Yeah. So they should do it. Even if you leave three open defensively against a mystical dispute, you should be fine. Yep, he's just hitting the QQ here. And he was just so kind to give his opponent 20 cards while he was at it. So yeah, I think we're looking at much of the same here in the sideboard. You know, same stuff we saw earlier from Hadouken. So probably not much is going to get moved here at this point. Though, you know, Mr. Hadouken is pretty good about choosing decks, because here we are looking at Temur Reclamation, and apparently last showdown played Jeskai Luka. So
yeah, it's we were talking about this earlier. It sounds like Mr. Hadouken is somebody who wants to show up with the best deck and wants to play it to the best of his ability, and seems to be doing just that. Though I agree with you, I thought last time clearly Jeskai Luka was the best deck, and I think it would be hard to argue at this point in the standard that you could argue for any other deck instead, you know, above Temur Rex. So I agree with your point for sure.
Yeah, in my experience, the couple of things I found that do well against Temur Rex have weaknesses elsewhere. So you know, you almost have to just decide. Are you going to try to go all in on Reclamation and then just hope to dodge the other matchups? You know, like it's a tough spot right now, especially in the early goings of a format where people may be bringing all kinds of stuff to the table. All right, getting right back into this one here, going into game two. All right, well, we found our fourth land right off the bat, so that's good. And you have two sharks here and some defensive counters. Though Nick's hand has, what's that, a cultivate? So, yeah. And he opted to bring in the wolves here.
Yeah, his Innistrad's hand looks pretty strong to me. Cultivate for ramp, also the Ambusher providing an instant speed threat, which is something like these ramp decks can be lacking against decks with a lot of control, counterspell type cards. I wonder if this will even be enough to draw out a counter from Mr. Hadouken. I kind of like it.
Yeah, I probably would too. I mean, knowing that it sets you up to have to start dealing with Nissa and whatnot the next turn is pretty tough. All right, so first spell being attempted goes for the Night Pack Ambusher. And it resolves. Possibly we're going to hit it with this Soul Seer.
Looks that way, and then if Nick is able to find a land, well, no Soul Seer, I guess, opting to just wait.
I mean, this is pretty savvy here, though, I guess, right? Because worst case scenario, you see what they do up until the end of turn. If nothing else, then you try to Soul Seer it. They'll have a 2-2 left over, and that's not so bad. And you don't get yourself exposed to Nissa.
Right. I mean, I wonder if you can just play it now in the second main phase after the... Well, or now it's fine, too. No, it's not. Because now if they just let this happen, they still get a 2-2. You could have prevented this after the Temple of Mystery came down and sort of prevented any big threats, but whatever. I think mostly Hadouken's worried about Nissa. So...
yeah, worst case scenario, it looks like with this hand, you'll take maybe two more damage here and then can cycle your shark to start blocking the following turns.
Yeah, that seems reasonable. Another ambusher from Einextrad, pretty good though.
Yep. And all we're drawing is lands off those last two draws, so that's not going to do a whole lot. And the sharks are pretty much on blocking duty here. And a brazen bar.
Yeah, a really strong draw.
Yeah, we're going to tap out, make a shark. That, unfortunately, as we can see, is not even going to get to the blocking step, I wouldn't imagine. Yep, Petty Theft picks up that 4-4 shark. We do trade a shark for a small wolf. But we're now down to 8, and it's not looking good.
Currently, Mr. Hadouken without even a way to stop from dying just to the shark.
All right, draws two, and they are two more land. Yep. All right, so we even that up, getting ready for a game three. Yep, Hadouken looks and just said, nope, everything's good. Just going to go right back in. Hey, chat, who are y'all pulling for in this matchup here? Or are we just going to outright just say that the Team of Reclamation team is the bad guy? Oh, we have somebody pulling for the bat. Yep. That's what I thought. Like, Team Rex, the bad guy. Not a surprise. Not a surprise. Yep, it looks like that's pretty much a unanimous decision there. Nothing wrong with that, though. I totally get it. Any deck that's, you know, at any given point, 30-40% of the format, like, you do kind of root for that to be the one that loses. Nick's taking a long time sideboarding here, which is interesting, going into this third game.
Pretty good hand. Growth spiral into chemistry's insight in this kind of this kind of matchup where people are trying to sort of, you know, finesse threats through and stuff is really strong. Just anything you can do on your opponent's turn for advantage.
Yeah, you've got the four land you need. You know, you can crack a Fabled Passage safely here on your turn one. Growth spiral up to what you need. Like, this should be pretty solid. So it looks like Nick did... Oh, no. Okay, look, it didn't mulligan. I thought that's what was going on there. All right, decided to hold on to the Fabled Passage here. interesting. I think I would have been more hasty and tried to get that Fable Passage into play and cracked and out the way.
I think it just shows that Mr. Hadouken wants to draw lands, is not interested in thinning them out of his deck at this point.
All right, well, nobody's missing land drops for the first few turns, so we're going to get to see a little bit of back and forth. Attempting to cultivate.
I wonder if Mr. Hadouken would consider expansioning this cultivate. Guess not. I guess he's content to just play Chemist's Insight.
Yeah, look, he's giving it a long think. Maybe it was something that the guy considered there. I mean, because cultivate is definitely a card that benefits both these decks, for sure. And the Chemist's Insight is met with a Mystical Dispute there. I think that speaks to what you were saying, that, you know, in this type of matchup, having extra cards is that important.
Yeah, for sure.
It was still worth countering.
Still not a land, though, for Mr. Hadouken.
That's rough.
And there's one.
Now, what would be the logic there on not wanting to cast the Mystical Dispute against that Hydroid Crisis?
Mostly he's just far behind and needs to hit land drops to catch up. He also has the Soul Seer in hand, which doesn't do that much in the matchup. So kind of happy to just use that eventually, though not right now, to take out the Crisis. He's still in a position where he needs to develop his mana and ramp up to Uro. If Nick doesn't do anything, potentially Mr. Hadouken might do something like Soul Seer at end of turn, but that remains to be seen.
All right, there's a Scavenging Ooze.
It's actually pretty annoying here because best case scenario, it takes out your Uro. However, you are putting another 2-mana threat onto the board that has Blast Zone on it.
All right, so we're going to opt. Looks like we're responding with removing the Uro, which is probably going to be the Scavenging Ooze's number one job over the next 90 days or so. All right, just loading up the Blast Zone. Setting up to take out both those 2-mana creatures. We did find a 6th land.
A lot of threats right now, though, staring down Mr. Hadouken. He's trying his best to play at instant speed and not lose to a Nissa, but it's getting harder and harder as his disadvantage gets bigger and bigger.
Yeah, and sometimes it's just what you're hoping to do on some level, force the other player that's trying to play at instant speed to do stuff on their turn. Just say like, okay, you have to deal with something.
Yeah, I mean, I guess here he can still afford to take another hit with this Blast Zone on 2. But it looks like Nick is going to go here for this Nissa with 3-mana up, which means it can't be disputed.
Yeah, I think Hadouken just saw that. Yeah, and it's not worth casting the dispute if you're trying to get rid of those other creatures, because you need three for the blast zone, which really costs you four lands.
Right.
All right, so Nissa does make her way to the table.
And with this Brazen Borrower in hand for Nick, I don't know if there's anything that Mr. Hadouken's going to be able to try to do here.
Yeah, because even if you crack the Blast Zone, that at least gets rid of seven here. But then you take.
I think the problem is, even if your opponent doesn't have anything, the Blast Zone line is too weak. Yeah. I think he's forced to go for something like this with the Commence, but the Petty Theft just going to bounce the 7-7, stop it from having any sort of advantage at all, and really put Mr. Hadouken in a really tough position here.
Yeah, it's a hard spot. Now you're at four. I mean, no way to get... Well... Nah, because you still have seven, even though, yeah, this is a hard one.
Maybe if you had drawn Reclamation and a land there, and you could have had a bunch of mana, there might have been some line to find a way to survive. But as it sits, I don't see it.
Yeah, I'm just trying to think through it, saying, okay, you use the Blast Zone, but they only have two mana open. You could Aether Gust Elspeth, but then, or Nissa, but then it just comes back down, and you're going to take another six anyway. You could Soul Seer something, but yeah, that's still going to end up being the game. All right, so it looks like Inex Strahd is still in the opponent, and we will have a new CFB Pro Showdown champion for the second event.
Good run for Mr. Hadouken, though.
Yeah, this. Definitely nothing to be ashamed of there. Made a good run. Got three or four rounds deep.
I was actually impressed by Mr. Hadouken's play, too. I said it before, but just to say it again, because that'll be the last we see of Mr. Hadouken today. But
cool. Well, you know, let's take a quick break. We're going to get the next round set up, and we will be right back.